The most quoted works in all history are the Bible, Shakespeare, The Godfather, and Apocalypse Now. The first was arguably from Shakespeare, the second arguably from God, and the others from a god, Francis Ford Coppola. It's uncanny how moments in Francis's films become metaphors for our own quotidian challenges, experiences, and warnings. But then everything about Francis's films are uncanny. Francis brings the passion we so clearly see in his movies to every part of his life. Under the Francis Ford Coppola Presents banner, he markets his films and videos, resorts, cafes, a literary magazine, a winery, a line of pastas, and pasta sauce. Leading today's discussion is Jay McInerney, a prominent writer in fiction, journalism, and film. He's currently writing a wine column for Town and Country magazine. In 2006, he won the James Beard MFK Fisher Award for distinguished writing for his food and wine work. They have an awful lot to talk about. I also have to say that both these gentlemen were part of the very first Tribeca Film Festival in 2002, and I will always be grateful to them for joining us then and joining us now. Thank you all very much. And now please welcome Francis and Jay.
Thank you, Jay. Thank you. Well, I had a lovely and witty introduction to you written. I'm not sure if I should, I think Jane has obviated the need for that very gracefully, but let me start more or less in the middle, if I can find my glasses.
I told them over there, I said, you know, I have absolutely no idea what we're going to talk about. So I love that, because then I'll really talk.
It's true. I resisted the urge to send Francis the questions. But let's start in the middle, more or less. And by that I mean Apocalypse Now. At a press conference in Cannes after the release of that film, you said something very prescient things about movie making. For instance, you said, cinema is the most potent force of modern times, and it's going to radically change. World cinema will be electronic, it will be digital, and it will bounce off satellites, and it will create the dreams and hallucinations of the future. And it will change the world. This was 1979, or maybe 1980. How prescient do you think you were?
Well, you know, as a former boy scientist, I always was interested in technology. And of course, art depends, always has depended on technology, from the first paintings to, of course, the cinema was impossible until they invented camera and the other means of recording. And I just knew it was going to be electronic for reasons we could talk about if you would want to. But I was positive it was going to be electronic. And I saw that once picture became electronic, because sound was already electronic, and then subsequently digital, which is another way of saying electronic, I guess. But I knew, you know, we as young filmmakers knew that the soundtrack was very malleable and you could manipulate it. And, you know, since the 50s, when we saw Les Paul and Mary Ford, you could have sound on sound recording and you could make one saxophone sound like 20 saxophones. It was such a magic, promiscuous form, whereas picture was, of course, still photochemical, and so you had to cut pieces of film together. And I knew that once the picture became also digital and would become as promiscuous as was the soundtrack, then the film, you wouldn't cut a film, you would compose a film. But I also knew, I was sure that in the future, and I said as much at some Academy Award ceremony when I think we gave the award to Michael Cimino, and I said, but before we give the award, I want to say a few minutes about the future of the something is coming that is going to change everything. I knew that once every projector in every theater in the world was basically an electronic projector instead of a film projector, that then you wouldn't bring film cans to the projector, you would just supply it with digital files, and it could play a different movie in a different place. It could be totally changeable. In fact, it could be a live performance, a cinema live performance. So to me, coming into the digital age meant a real evolution of the form.
Well, I spoke to you a few months ago in Napa, and one of the things you told me then was that when your career was starting, there was talk about the threat to the movies from television. That certainly television was a new medium which would seem to pose challenges. When I was writing my first novel, there was a lot of talk about the novel being dead, being threatened by other art forms and being obsolete. And obviously, both the narrative film and the novel have survived and continue to find their audiences. But at the same time, it doesn't seem to me they've changed all that much in the last 30 or 40 years.
Well, I think the novel has changed a lot. And the novel is, what, about 400 years old? I mean, yeah. If you Don Quixote or Goethe. And so much has happened in the novel, the manipulation of point of view. We could talk and talk about the changes.
No, but I mean, let's say in the last 30 years. I mean, not modernism and postmodernism.
Well,
but,
even in the last 30 years, I think you get into the younger writers, what's his name, Infinite Jest, what have you. The form is continually to evolve. And it went through a big transition with the French, Flaubert who wrote the Charterhouse of Parma?
Stendhal.
And then of course, went through the James Joyce, Virginia Woolf period of great. So I think as a form, the novel has gone through many, many exciting transitions.
Oh, yeah, but I mean,
Alain Robbe-Grillet.
But there was talk of the novel being dead. I mean, Tom Wolfe was the most famous proponent of this theory, and then he went on to become more famous by writing a novel, called *The Bonfire of the Vanities*.
Well,
how would you say that these changes that you quite rightly predicted have changed the form of storytelling?
Unfortunately, what I had in mind did happen, but aspects of it were embraced and used to make the superhero movies because of digital effects. And I knew that in the realm of the digital cinema, anything you could dream up would be possible, but I failed to adjust for the fact that what they dream up is something that could make money by doing things in a way that maybe is titillating or exciting. But I mean, you see some of the spectacular things possible in the big blockbuster movies, and you look at them and you sort of shrug a little because you know it's a form of animation, really, that it's not really happening. But prepared well, those beautiful capabilities could, what's happened today in the movie business, there's a split between the so-called studio pictures, which have too much money, which are basically the franchises of, five Iron Man pictures and five Spider-Man pictures, and the independent cinema made by our very talented younger filmmakers we can include Woody Allen with that group, who are just love the form and just keep pouring it out, and they don't have enough money to, their budgets are very miserly. But this is a time, as always, of great transition and the cinema as well. All our institutions seem to be changing right in front of our eyes. Marriage, journalism, religion, politics. Who would have imagined politics would become reality television, So while our very, institutions are the bedrock that we rest on, and so since they're changing, this becomes a quite an exciting quite an exciting time. But with the cinema, I'm sure that what I'm sure is going to happen is the so-called ownership, the establishment of the cinema, which is now in the hands of cable companies and telephone companies, is going to shift, because I don't believe that the internet, social media companies can have their industry founded on social media. They're going to have content at some point. I mean, anyone who goes to one of them, like a Facebook or something, knows that after a while you become bored with it and you don't even want to go back anymore beyond grandparents seeing their grandchildren's pictures. So those companies have so much money that ultimately I think they're gonna want movies. They're gonna want, not movies, but content. They're gonna want to have something to look at. Yahoo, you know, they're wondering, well, who's gonna come to Yahoo? We don't have anything really we can offer. It was really a search company originally. So I feel that the ownership of the cinema is going to change. Also, one thing we've seen is cinema and television has become the same thing. Those wonderful long television, like starting with Sopranos and Breaking Bad, those are movies. Yep. So it's all cinema. Excuse me. There is no more television as such. There's cinema, and it can be seen in the home. It can be seen in the theater. It can be and will be seen in both the home and the theater. And it could be a minute or less, or it could be 90 hours or more. So now we have this new exciting category of cinema, which is about to have new ownership.
Have you ever considered long-form television?
I hate that word, long-form television, but I love what Eugene O'Neill would call a cycle of plays. Mm-hmm. That's a turn-on. Morning becomes Electra was four plays, I guess, or back to Methuselah was more. So I don't even know how many plays that was. So yeah, I've become very interested in a particular corner of what I think the future will be, and I've been, at age 77, I've sort of assigned myself a five-year project that's to for sure get me into my 80s. So that's what I'm doing these days, and it's related to what I think is one aspect of the future of cinema.
Well, as long as you brought us there, let's talk about it, because...
We're not going to talk about wine.
No. Well, we can get to wine, but
yeah, we could be getting to wine while we're talking about the future.
But let's talk about Distant Vision.
Distant Vision is actually was an old phrase used to describe what is essentially television back in the 19th century. People don't realize that what we call television really came about in different levels and experiments, probably around the time of the invention of the telephone. So it's really possible that television could have emerged and become a medium that the public used before cinema, which would have been very interesting, because when television did come on the scene in Europe in the 30s and in America in the 40s, it used the language that cinema had invented.
Right.
But would have been very curious had a television come first, which was technically possible, it existed, and then you wonder what it would have been like, because it would have been, it wouldn't have had this extraordinary vocabulary and language that cinema evolved and which television borrowed. So, you know, it would have been used by an English couple looking at a screen and saying hello to their daughter in salon. What is the thing Apple does with the camera? It's called, it would have been used like that. You know, detectives in New York would have seen the perpetrators of the crime in Chicago because it couldn't record. So it's very curious to think how that would have influenced the cinema when it was born. So it was called Distant Vision, Distant Electric Vision, Distant Vision. And even in the 20s, there was an American named Francis Jenkins who was broadcasting to home radio ham operators a little television box called Radio Vision, I think it was called. And so the history of television goes way, 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 way back. And the urge to see at a distance, of course, was probably an ancient fantasy. So. What I'm doing is I'm writing a long piece, a cycle of plays, you could call it, called Distant Vision, which is a little bit like Buddenbrook's. It's the story of an Italian family, much like my own, three generations. So the, you know, four marriages, the grandparents' marriage, the parents' marriage, and the younger people's marriage. And just as Buddenbrook's was told over great changes in Hanseatic Germany, in the merchants, and what was happening in Germany, my story of four generations of a family like mine takes place over the conception and the birth and the ultimate dominance of television over the period of time that those families. So it's about a family like, not unlike my own, although it's fiction, and it's about the story of television and to try to understand how television has impacted us, as we know. You know, I was thinking when I was trying to dream up what I would write about, I was thinking, you know, what my era, I was born in 1939, so my era is the end of World War II. If we said to someone a little older, what was your era, what was your time about, they would say World War II. But I'm just after World War II, and I thought, well, what is mine? Mine is the 40s, the 50s, you know, the changes in civil rights, the Vietnamese War, and I realized it's television. Everything we did or saw or thought about somehow was determined by television and our interreaction with it, so I thought I wanted that as a subject matter.
But formally, it sounds like you're trying to do something very different from a conventional film script, which you subsequently direct.
Yeah, well, what this is since it's, I felt it was about that subject, I thought, well, the form itself should be live cinema. And I said, well, what's live cinema? And I said, well, I don't really know, because no one has, I know what live television is. Live television is when they do The Sound of Music and they have a lot of cameras and they sort of produce The Sound of Music and it looks like a television play, but cinema doesn't look like that. It doesn't look like The Young and the Restless. It looks, so I, you know, in my career, I've always been in a situation where I'm doing something big and ambitious, and I'm trying to sell people to sponsor me, like with Apocalypse Now. And the truth is, I had no idea how I was going to do what I was saying I was going to do. But when I got there, I mean, how am I going to destroy villages with helicopters and all this stuff? I had no idea how to do it. But step by step, we learned. And so when I talk about live cinema, which is something I'm sure of, that you will be able to see something that looks like a beautiful movie, and yet it will be being performed live for you, I wasn't exactly sure how I would do what I had in my heart and my imagination. So what I began to do is take like 20 or 30 pages and do a kind of a proof of concept, experimental workshop somewhere, and try to find some place where I could go. So a couple of years ago, I went to Oklahoma, and where I was welcome at a film school in Oklahoma, and they said, "Well, we'll give you students and all these facilities." And so I did like a 50. Well, how many? It was 50 minutes, excuse me, of what was basically an experiment to try to express what live cinema was. And I would take notes every morning. I'd write to myself, and I was, you know, watch how it was going. I had some repertory actors from the Oklahoma City, Dallas area, and they were working with me on this material, and I would say, well, this is definitely not theater, and it's definitely not television, and it's definitely not movies. So what is it? I said, I don't know. Why is it not those things? Like, and it's because the basic unit of live cinema, just as your work of the novel, the basic unit of the novel is the sentence. If you have a beautiful sentence, and then you have a few beautiful sentences, you're on your way to a beautiful paragraph, and ultimately, that's the basic unit. in television, the basic unit is the event. It could be a ball game, it could be The Sound of Music, it could be when they do the opera. That's basically a kind of live television. They have the opera with the sets, and they have a lot of cameras trying to stay out of each other's way. But cinema, the basic unit is the shot. It's shot-based. There's the shot, and we've learned from the masters, Eisenstein and the pioneers, that the shot cuts to another shot, and it makes a meaning that neither of them could make. So you build cinema out of shots. So then I realized, well, that's totally different than the way they do live television. It's more like as if you had a storyboard, a Pixar storyboard, and the actors are running through and they're performing those shots. And somehow you're able to cut them and show them on this projector, and the people are seeing a movie, but it's a live performance. And I guess what I felt was that why should we give up performance just because we have this beautiful cinema that now has existed for 100 and some odd years? Wouldn't it be great if you could still have performance? Like, you know, when they were doing opera at Dresden in 1850, they were big, elaborate productions. They had choruses, they had, and the maestro, who was the director of the opera house, was like a movie director because he was involved in everything. But at the moment, he got up in front of you, the audience, and he raised his hand and they performed it. Well, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could do that? I thought, being an old ex-theater student, if we could perform cinema. And of course, with it all being electronic, it is possible. It could be all around the world. Everyone could see a new film by whomever and see it live with the thrill of the actors doing the timing and not the editors. So that was sort of the holy grail I started to go after. And I experimented in Oklahoma, and I did about 50 minutes, and we broadcast it. You know, my wife saw it in Paris, and my friends saw it in New York, my daughter. And I believe it's definitely, it will not be the entire cinema of the future, but that there will be live productions that are cinematic and look like movies and behave like movies.
But is this an ongoing project? And do you have a script that you're continuing to work from?
Yeah, I think I'm doing it again. I'm going to do it at UCLA. And each time I do it, I have a different experiment. And in Oklahoma, my first experiment is how do you get it to look not like just like The Young and the Restless? The reason it looks like that is because they are concerned that the cameras not photograph themselves. So they tend to shoot it all with zoom lenses so that they can come in close. Zoom lenses, those kind of cameras, zoom lenses are very, it's a lot of glass, so they need a lot of light. So the lighting is all done from a big grid. And that combination of this big grid that illuminates everything and these long lenses which eat up the light gives it the live television look that Peter Pan had, or even Grease had when they did it recently. But movies are lit from the floor. Movies are lit from the lamp in the room or through the window, and the lenses that used in movies are much more efficient, so they don't need a lot of light. So we shot in Oklahoma with those kind of lenses for the most part and didn't use the grid at all, just had lights that we could, you know, because a lot of actors running around scene after scene after scene, we were pushing lights and things around, but it looked like a movie. Didn't look like a. So that experiment confirmed to me, okay, that's how you would do that. You would light from the floor and at a much lower light level. So in Oklahoma now, I'm going to experiment with three other things. So each time I do it, I try to learn another notch of how to do it. And then I'm going to do the whole thing. The script is almost 500 pages long, so it's like 6 plays.
Oh, but right now it sounds like filmed theater.
Not at all.
Okay.
Why does it sound like?
Well, I want you to clarify because it's
shot-based. In other words, it's a theater is you have a set. Like they're going to do a live production. What was the movie that Jack Nicholson did? It was a play Jack Nicholson did with, it was a movie with military. Fugerman, they're going to do that on NBC. So, of course, that's perfect for them because it's a courtroom drama. So they have a courtroom, and then they have a lot of cameras. That's a film play. If they ask me, would you like to do some experiment, I would say, yeah, I want to do Lawrence of Arabia.
Right. Okay.
I mean, that's a joke, but it's the difference. It's the difference between telling a story through quanta of images and, on the other hand, a set that has, you know, positions and you stage it, which is not how I do it. But it's shot-based, and it goes from a designed shot to a designed shot to a designed shot. And it looks like, also, you know, you have to realize that a lot of evolution has happened since the great days of live television, Playhouse 90, but it's happened in sports. They've invented all kinds of technology to facilitate sports. And just to learn, I mean, have you ever wondered how in a baseball game someone hits a home run and the guy runs around and you get the reactions of the people? But they always have the shot where he goes into the dugout and everyone gives him high fives and he goes and he gets some Gatorade. Now, how is it they're always able to get that shot? Because what there was an argument and the umpires were arguing. Couldn't it have happened that they're stuck on that? And so when they get to the dugout, it's too late. He's already drinking the Gatorade. They always have that shot because they have equipment, in this case it's called EVS, that enables them to control time. They can isolate time while the sports are going on, and they can show you, and it happens in real time, but they're able to manipulate time. So I said, well, what happens if I use that for storytelling purposes, if I have control over time? And that's one example of some of the advances that have been made for sports that you could use in an enterprise like mine.
So it sounds like you've talked sometimes about the outsized influence that editing has in shaping film, and it sounds like you're sort of somewhat bypassing the editing
process. You're still editing, but you're editing a little more, as they do in movies anyway, before the fact, because cinema has this wonderful property which we only have because the pioneers were able to experiment. I mean, I often talk about the guts it must have taken from an early film director to, you know, because at first it looked like a play. They had the actors full, you know, or cut at the knee or full form, and then someone had a close shot. And it always occurs to me how gutsy that was. How would they be sure that the audience would accept that? Suddenly I'm looking at a great big close-up of someone. And of course, you know, how would we know that the audience would just say, look what he's thinking in the scene. But the mind of the audience makes that work. Or the girl is tied to the railroad track and the villain is tying her, and then you cut to a locomotive. How did they know that the audience would put the locomotive shot, which is just another shot, and say that girl's in danger? This is the wonderful invention in the language of cinema that they did, aided by this extraordinary human mind that puts these things, and each of you make that work story-wise. So if you don't get to experiment, do outrageous things like that, how can you move forward? How can you discover what the rules of live cinema is? What you have to do is you have to pre-imagine, as you do anyway when you make a movie, the effect that going from this shot to this situation to that shot. And that's why Pixar just spends years drawing storyboards and trying to figure it all out beforehand. So a little bit in live cinema, you have to figure it out beforehand, because there are no real sets as such. There are shots. What I learned in my Oklahoma experience, and I want to continue with the next one I'm doing, is that instead of having a scene, okay, here's the drawing room, and the actors are getting drinks and blah, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to say, okay, here's the shot. Put a piece of the liquor bottles in the left on the frame, and make there be a door over there, and there's a window, and let there be light. In other words, I would build the shot out of the frame rather than an existing set that's there, and then go to the next shot, do the same thing, piece it together out of the malleable elements of the actors and the furniture and the tools that I have, so that when you see it cut, it performs like cinema rather than a play that's being covered, you know, or an opera in the movie theater in the afternoon. It's a very different looking effect. It looks like a movie.
You talked earlier about commercial studio filmmaking versus independent filmmaking. It seems to me that you came of age and partly helped to shape an age when that line seemed to blur for a moment. I mean, The Godfather was conceived of in many ways as a commercial film, and yet many people consider it one of the greatest and most innovative films of all time. Was there a moment there, an open window, when commercial and independent filmmaking were not so dichotomized as they are today?
Well, I think the important factor was, again, the timing that myself, my generation, were raised with the twin influences of the European cinema and Hollywood cinema. I was, 19 and 1959 or whatever. We were seeing these great Italian films and the great Japanese films and the French films and the Swedish films of Bergman. Those of you who haven't seen Marty Scorsese's beautiful documentary called Viaggio in Italia, has anyone seen that? Marty gives a lecture on the Italian cinema from before Rossellini on. Very, very wonderful. To think what the Italians had, they had 40 great film directors at once. It's never happened again. So we were knocked out by these extraordinary films at age 16, age 17, and then to throw in Orson Welles and John Frankenheimer on television to boot. And then there was the American cinema. There was William Wyler's great The Best Years of Our Lives, and John Ford, and George Stevens' A Place in the Sun. So there was beauty hitting us from two angles, so that when we came to our opportunity in the 70s, the studios were a little bit in disarray, as they are now. They weren't quite sure what movies to make.
The success of Easy Rider really threw them, didn't it?
The success of Easy Rider definitely was saying, well, maybe we should make films, but for young people. And they said, well, what's that? Well, Easy Rider definitely showed it. So we got our chance.
Paul Schrader said after that they gave you guys the keys for a while.
Well, we sort of swiped them. They didn't really give us anything. But what the films we did were doubly influenced by Kurosawa and Wyler, or Billy Wilder and Fellini. So I think it was a very unique time. And the same thing happened then later, when these talented writers and directors who wanted to make that kind of cinema and didn't have the chance to, the guy David Chase, who made The Sopranos, he wanted to be making films in the 70s, so he made his television in that. So that you always use the opportunity you have to try to fulfill your dreams, and that's all we did. I mean, when you're a film director, like on a movie like The Godfather, all I was trying to do was not get fired every week.
Yeah.
In truth, I mean, I was so scared. I had three kids, or two and one imminently on the way, and when the baby was born, that was the baby in The Godfather. Turns out it was Sophia. It wasn't even a boy, it was Sophia. So I was pretty scared.
Yeah, and they didn't want Marlon Brando, did they?
They didn't want Marlon Brando, and you know the story. We don't have to go over, but it's true. So, in Apocalypse Now, I was terrified. I had a $32 million loan at 29% with everything I had amassed up against it, which is why I own Apocalypse Now at this moment. It's because no one would do it, no one wanted to do it, and I was able to borrow the money. At that kind of interest, by the way.
I'm curious, after all the turmoil of making that film, the typhoon and the heart attack of Martin Sheen and and all the negative press while you were making it, I think the critical assessment of the film was very favorable. You once again won the Palme d'Or.
Slowly. The critical success of Apocalypse, it improved over time. People kept seeing it.
But there was the Palme d'Or relatively early on.
Yeah.
I mean, but does all of that turmoil, the difficulty of making the film, when you look back on it, do you Do you feel all of that Sturm und Drang, or do you see the completed project?
I feel more relief. I mean, I was so scared, to be honest with you. I mean, I was so frightened, but I didn't know any other way to do it, except fumble my way through it. When I look back, and I had my share of bad reviews for all those pictures, but I realized that I made Godfather 1, The Conversation, Godfather 2, and Apocalypse Now, one after another in about 4.5 years. But I was so depressed. I had won 5 Oscars, and no one would let me do Apocalypse. So I took the Oscars, I was so mad, and I threw them out the window of my house. And they landed down in the garden all mangled. And they're just dross, by the way. You know, they're all broken and stuff. So my mother went and picked up all the pieces, and she went to the Academy. She says, "Oh, my son's Oscars, the maid was dusting them, and they fell down." they're mangled, you know. But that was my sentiment. What do you have to do to be able to make the films that you have to make, that you know, because film is an expensive medium. I mean, you can't just go out and do it. You have to have the resources. So, my youth, that young period, because I was, before I was 30 and then after 30, I was sort of tortured and, what have you. I'm much more stress-free now.
But thanks
to the wine business, not to the movie.
Well, I was going to say, at the height of your success, I believe in 75, you went up to Napa and you bought this beautiful historic estate.
A home, yeah, it was a home.
He bought a beautiful mansion in the Napa Valley, and it went along with a very important vineyard, which Francis subsequently added to and he completed and reclaimed the Inglenook Vineyard, which is probably the most famous and most historically important vineyard in Napa.
19th century, vineyard created by a Finn, a Finnish American gentleman who was one of the wealthiest men in the country.
Gustav Niebaum.
Yeah, so it wasn't, mostly New World wineries are immigrants go to Argentina or go to America, and then like Mr. De Gallo's or Mr. Mondavi's father, and they make wine for other immigrants because many Europeans, of course, consider wine something that's at the table. I never saw a table in my life that didn't have a glass of wine on it because it was just something people drank with dinner. But Niebaum was different. He was so wealthy. Actually, he was wealthy because he was Finnish, which was part of Russia, and he was the administrator for Alaska. So when Alaska was bought by the Americans, he knew all of what was there, and he went and made a fortune in shipping and taking seal pelts and other resources. So he made, one load of those seal pelts would be worth $500,000 in 1860. So what was $500,000 in 1860? So he was very rich. And he married as an older man. His wife wanted him to quit traveling. So rather than go to France and buy up all the first growths, he bought this beautiful property and invested in very advanced viniculture and vinification process and made this Inglenook, which won all of these awards back turn of the century. So it's really an American treasure.
It is. I had a 1955 Inglenook with you the first time I met you, and it was quite a sensational wine. Yeah.
They were among the greatest wines of the world. A bottle of 1941 Inglenook, you could go to an auction, you'll pay $25,000 for it. So back, for the 40s.
At what point did you realize that you wanted to start making wine at this property?
I just was living there with my kids, and it was such a pretty place, and I got, I like to have a glass of wine with my dinner, like my father before me. I began to get the idea a little earlier than maybe the others that it was not going to be good for movie directors that you wouldn't be able to make the projects, your dream projects, that it was... The studios were getting wise to us, and were what they call vetting you.
They were
taking the keys back after Heaven's Gate, and it's true because today a movie director, what do you do if some of the greats Marty and Steven can still, but it's an effort to do a personal film. They more are under pressure to do what is commercially viable. So I wanted to get out of that. My livelihood was based on making movies, and I was very fortunate in that I, from Inglenook, actually, the young lady, I guess Jane was wrong, I have three wineries. One makes those wines that you see everywhere, that the Coppola Claret or the Coppola, and then recently we've started once again for you older folks, Virginia Dare. Do you remember Virginia Dare? I always loved Virginia Dare because it had this pretty blonde girl, like a fairy tale on it. And there was a song, say it again, Virginia Dare. So we started the Virginia Dare Winery, revived it. And the wineries, thanks to all of you, do very well. And I often joke that you should all be credited as associate producers of what films I do, because that's what's paying for it.
And you should all visit the winery if you're anywhere near Napa.
You'd be more than welcome.
Not only do you get a lot of the history of wine there, but also the history of Francis's films.
Just to wrap up the live cinema thing, because I don't feel that I've been very... The reason I can't describe the process too well is because I don't know how to do it. And it's like someone invented a beautiful new musical instrument and no one's ever played it. So I want to try to learn how to play it. So right now I'm doing it with these little workshops, but eventually it's my dream to do it. And you know, those of you who follow this stuff know that there's a big argument between the theater owners and the producers and filmmakers as to they want you to go to the theater to see the film 6 weeks before you can get it at home, and when in fact, the truth is that you're going to be able to see it in the theater or at home or wherever you want to, because you are the boss of that. You are the patron, and the theater owners can't make those kind of stipulations if the audience. So to me, to go to the theater is a wonderful experience. I love to go to the movie theaters, although I yell at the screen when you go there. I go with my wife in Napa, and I yell at the screen because they show commercials in a movie theater. And that's what, you know, back when Pat Weaver started the first attempt at pay TV, the theater owners said, oh, you'll pay for it, but they'll show commercials on it. And they used to have you sign a list of your names to protest that pay TV will show you ads, which indeed they do. But now the theaters show you ads too, so that really, really bugs me. But it's wonderful to go see a movie in a theater with the full big screen, and it's also wonderful nowadays with the extraordinary home screens that you can have. But it's all cinema, it's no more television than
but
movies.
Do you think that there's something to be said for the communal experience of the
totally.
Of the theater? Because it seems to me we're headed to a world in which we're sitting even in the same room watching different things devices.
The theater experience is... My little granddaughter tells me that she's 29, but when they go to the movies, they always go the first night because they want the excitement of seeing it with an audience before someone tells them whether it was good or bad. You know, that's why people like live... That's why people... rock shows and stuff, because there is a hunger. I mean, we're looking at canned entertainment. Some of it's great, but nonetheless, it's canned. And there is a thrill to go. And I'm sure there are those of you in the audience tonight who were there on the first night of seeing Streetcar Named Desire or Long Day's Journey. And you know, you'll never forget that your whole life, or Aida. Or God knows what. Yeah. So that's one of the human thrills, is to sit in a great performance with your fellow audience, and that can be for the cinema as well. And it will be. I mean, I don't think all films will be created live, but some will. And there, you know, the cinema, I always like to think, well, gee, I wonder what their grandchildren's grandchildren will make. If I could get a glimmer to see that, what those little kids are going to make, it'll be something we can't even imagine. But I know it will be thrilling. I know it will be thrilling.
Well, and I have 37 other questions to ask you. I've been told that I have to turn the.
You're going to give me.
I have to turn the mic over to the audience at this point.
Oh, that's good. I love the audience.
So it's time for your questions.
How do we do it? Do we choose the young lady with glasses?
I have a few questions, actually.
let's try and keep it to a minimum here.
Yeah, no. I have just two, actually, specifically. I study at Sarah Lawrence College, which is not really a film school, but we have, like, a small community. We're very dedicated to everything that we do over there, and I think that your project is something that will work very, very well for our community. So if that's something you're interested in, that would be awesome. And on top of that, I was wondering for your project for, like, I had a completely different question in my head when I first came here, but...
What was the name of that school? Because maybe I'll take
Sarah
it up.
Sarah Lawrence College. It's
which one? Sarah Lawrence.
Oh, I visited Sarah Lawrence.
He's a New York guy.
Do you know that Brian De Palma, that genius, went to Sarah Lawrence when it was an all-girls school because they would accept a couple of men in the drama department. So he was one of like three men in all of Sarah Lawrence.
Good deal.
I could have done that. Because I was a theater major. Excuse me.
I'm sorry. Yeah, so it's a great school. It's in Bronxville. We're a very, very small community. But everyone is super dedicated over there to film craft in general. But my second question is, you were talking about making the future of television more live-based, and I was wondering if you ever consider doing anything interactive in terms of having the audience kind of have their choose-your-own-adventure with, like, a stream of different, like, a tree of different plot lines that can kind of condense into one thing in the end?
Well, you know, if I were to talk to you about the five possible ways the cinema would change, the idea of performing cinema live is just one of them. What you're talking about is the one I can know the least about, which is where we're making the cinematic experience through some sort of connection on the internet or even involving the Oculus. I mean, more what online gaming is, although I can't quite put it in a dramatic context yet. You can. She has it. Well, we're all gonna make you rich shortly, which is not such great shakes. But yes, definitely that's one of the five things I would talk. Another one, since you're a young lady, that I think is the whole idea of the documentary. I could talk about a lot of different ways the cinema can be new, you know. But one of it is when the documentary form, which is so interesting and such a beautiful form, is used to become more personal, the way Sarah Polley did on her film called Stories People Tell. Did you see that?
No, I haven't.
You know Sarah Polley?
Yeah.
Yeah, see that film. It's a beautiful film. But so there are many exciting avenues, and you can, a young person can do them all. Mm-hmm. But what you say, the interactive experience and more learning about how gaming works. I mean, gaming online is an extraordinary thing. There are people who just go online to watch the people play the game, who don't play it in themselves. It's very interesting. Thank you.
You want to pick another one?
let's get somebody over there, huh? Just the fellow right over there.
Hi, my name is Juan. I'm from Buenos Aires, Argentina. You went there shooting Tetro.
Yes.
Which I really enjoyed. I thought it was a perfect, little bit misunderstood movie. And my question is about that movie and maybe the last two or three. Do you feel like you're a film student again? I mean, like for the experimentation and all those things that you try.
Well, you know, I am well aware that some great artists, I'll say Tennessee Williams or a certain novelist I can think of, have a success very young. Williams had the Glass Menagerie and Streetcar Named Desire and lived a life of great heartbreak because he never could quite, or he did do some spectacular plays after that, work after that, but he always felt he was in competition with Streetcar or Glass Menagerie, and that could be true of a first novel. And it seems to be a pattern. I decide who was the who was James Jones? Did he was in.
Yeah,
or the guy who did. At any rate,
my agent told me that she was afraid that Bright Lights, Big City was going to be in the first line of my obituary, and that was 30 years ago.
Well, that's what happens. I mean, so I knew at age 65 that I was never going to make a film that connected with the public in the way that The Godfather did, and I didn't even see the point of trying. So I decided that an artist, when you have had the good fortune of coming on the scene very young, you should do a sort of kind of kill yourself in a form, and then come back and go back and be a student again and be reinvent yourself and work your way up again and see then what that new person. So I just when I think I was 65, I liked being 50 very much. I thought that was a wonderful age. So I called myself I'm 50-15. Now I'm 50-27. But I'm always in my 50s. So I decided I'm just going to be a student again, and I'm not going to. And I went off to Romania with my own money. I didn't have a lot of it, but I couldn't take the great photographer that I had always worked with, and I couldn't. You know, one of the biggest costs of films is when you go to these places, it's plane tickets and hotels, and the family of the people you want to work with have to go. And so I went alone. I went with my little granddaughter just to visit, and made a film there just with the resources I had. I met actors, they're wonderful actors in Romania, and Argentina has one of the greatest theater, more theater going on in Buenos Aires than anywhere I've ever seen. So there's tremendous resources, and I just found a young photographer who helped me shoot screen tests, and yes, it was like being a student again. I didn't have because the difference, a student doesn't have a lot of money to work with and doesn't have all those fantastic cinematographers and colleagues, and you're doing everything on a budget. So I decided to just try to make, and of course what I really wanted to be and what I still want to be and is a writer. I want to be able to write the stuff I make, so I was doing that and trying to build myself up. And it's very ironic because now I felt I had done that a few times. Whether your films are, you always think your films are misunderstood. I mean, even though people like them, there are some people who don't like them. I'm reading. I'm going to go to Bayreuth this year and see all these Wagner things. So I'm reading his book, and he's just always complaining that they don't like his stuff, and you know, they like Mendelssohn better. Well, Mendelssohn was great. So it's so funny to read the scenes where they're, you know, these great people are dealing with other great people that are all gods to us, and they're all snipping at each other and whatever. But at any rate, you're always insecure, and that's just part of it. It's ridiculous. So I made the three films, and then I thought, well, I'm ready to do something ambitious. So I decided what I wanted to do was kind of tell the story of television, but to tell it in a very personal way, like through my family. And then, of course, just when I had something I could really do, I said, yeah, but to do it live, because it's about. I love work that is what it's about. Apocalypse was a little bit about that. It was about madness, and it was madness the way we did it. You know what I mean about is what it's about? If you can do that, if it can both be about this thing and be this thing, that's thrilling. Mm-hmm. So I ended up now in this extremely difficult position of doing a thing that's really never quite been done before, and to try to do it and actually, I mean, my dream is in a few years to invite you to a theater like this on the first night, 8 o'clock, and we'll be going 3, 2, 1, go, and perform this first part of it, which would be about an hour and a half for you live, and then 3 months later do the second part, and then 3 months later do the third part. That's what I'm going to try to do. Yes.
Hi there. My name is Kim Blacklock, and I wanted to ask you about how you got involved with Fred Roos. He just gave a 72-year-old budding screenwriter his first movie. He just produced The Congressman. And I was just interested in that here he is at, I don't know what age he is, but giving new people you know,
early 80s, I would think, 80, 81 maybe.
So when did you first hook up with Fred Roos, and what was your relationship
like? I made a film called The Rain People back in whenever that was, the 60s, I guess. And Fred saw it. He was a sort of a talent manager, and not an agent, but a manager. And he said, well, you know, that I liked that film. It was something I had written. My dream was to write my own stuff. I didn't quite get to do it, but I wrote many of them. I wrote The Conversation. Anyway, Fred said, well, anytime you want help with casting, you know, give me a call. So then I was doing The Godfather, and I contacted him, and he helped me cast The Godfather. That's how I met him. But that's nothing. I mean, she's going to be mad at me for this. My wife is here, and my wife is... Would you stand up so I can introduce you so they see how... Stand up, stand up. My wife has just made her first feature film. We all saw it last night. It was quite beautiful. And it was her first time. This is not like a documentary. This is a written. She wrote it. She directed it and made her first film at age 80. No, not yet. And she'll be 80 in 4 weeks.
Well, that's a very happy note on which to unhappily end this session. Thank you, Francis.
We've been married 53 years.
I wish we could all ask you more questions, but we'll be waiting for Distant Vision, and thanks again. Thank you all.